And I was explaining to Trish that the dates have been a bit of a moving target, and I apologize for that this time. Usually I set them and they stay. But I think I started to set dates in February, then I moved into March. And so this is we finally were able to get three in a row. So today is the last one of the three out of three. And but I will do them again. I'll do them again soon. I think last year I did them again in July. It depends. I need to make sure I find 3 weeks in a row. So I apologize for the confusion, but I'm glad you're here. And I teach each class in a way that you can pick up something, you know, related to mindfulness. And I think we have more folks coming in. So So grab a seat. There's one over there. There's two here. And I'm going to shut this door. I think we're okay.
Well, no, I just drove up.
Are you guys coming in? There's two seats, I think, over that way. Hi, we're being taped today. So there's a seat there, and there's a seat there. And at some point, if you could just sign in, or if you want to give me, make sure if you got an email from me this week, then that I had your correct email. If you didn't get an email from me, just make sure it's clear. And what I will send you, let me know. I know that, where's the gentleman? A gentleman had asked me to send former stuff. I can do that. Also, I sent something via Dropbox, so a 10-minute awareness of breath meditation. I can give you access to that as well. So I know we're a little crunched in. If you feel like you need space, everybody can push back. Otherwise, say, it's okay. We're good. We are good. So how we start each of these is, before I get into any conversation, is let's turn off. Can you turn off that light by chance? Perfect. All right. So we're going to do something that's called an awareness of breath meditation. So the majority of you have done this by now. So what I'm going to ask you to do is you want your feet flat on the floor. Make sure your phones are on silence. Make sure mine is on silence or off. So everything's off your lap. And ideally, if you're at home, ideally, like these seats are kind of perfect for everybody, and that you want to make sure your body's not torqued. So, you know, sometimes if there's a tall seat and your legs are like way down to the floor, just prop something underneath. So your legs are always parallel to the floor. I think everybody's looking pretty good right now. Hands on your lap or folded, doesn't matter, whatever's most comfortable. So what I'm going to invite you to do is to either close your eyes or let your gaze go down and not looking at anything in particular, just unfocused. So choosing to figure out what makes the best sense for you. So as we begin to settle into our seats, your back is straight but not rigid, upright. Jon Kabat-Zinn often refers to a regal position. So you're holding yourself upright, your head, supported by your neck, supported by your torso. And so bringing your attention first to all the physical sensations of being seated in this moment. So perhaps noticing your feet on the floor, and then noticing the next point of contact, so perhaps your legs and your buttocks, your back, your hands on your lap. So noticing all the points of supporting surface and the physical sensations of sitting here. So perhaps even noticing where the distribution of your weight is as you're sitting on this chair. And And then scanning your body from head to toe and noticing if there's any tension or tightness. And not doing anything about it, just noticing it. And then when you're ready, I'm going to invite you to change your attention, switching your attention to sitting here breathing. So we breathe every moment of the day, but very rarely do we make our attention focus specifically on the act of breathing. So without doing anything specific or manipulating your breath, just beginning to observe the in-breath and the out-breath, and noticing your body breathing. So for some people, it's easier to focus on the nose and the nostrils, noticing the air flow in and out. For some people, it may be easier to sustain your attention on the chest, the expansion of the ribs, and the contraction, so the inflow and outflow through your lungs. And for some people, it's easier to focus on the belly. So if you're new to this focus on the breath, it's common in the very beginning to feel a sense of anxiousness or anxiety begin to start as you focus so intently on your breath. So if you're feeling any of that kind of inkling of anxiety and unable to catch your breath, I'm going to invite you to breathe deeply into your belly. It might even help to put your hand on your belly. So doing what you can to focus deeply into the belly and noticing the movements in and out. So for each of you, picking an area, the nose, the chest, or the belly, and you're going to do the best you can to bring your curiosity to that area as you breathe in and breathe out. Now, if it hasn't happened already, it's very normal for the mind to wander. That's what it does. The mind wanders. So if you notice that your mind has wandered away from the breath, that's okay. Just with kindness and compassion, bringing your attention back to the breath and to whatever area you're focusing on. So we're going to do our best to focus on five breaths on your own, and continually bringing your attention back. So with curiosity and kindness, observing the inhalation to its fullest and the exhalation to its fullest. So for some people, it helps to count. For other people, it may help to say, I'm breathing in peace and breathing out calm. And I heard a new one recently, breathing in, letting, breathing out, go. Letting go. So observing the body breathing. When you're ready, opening your eyes and beginning to take in the room. So I'm going to ask, could you just turn on one of the lights since you're back there? Thanks. Good. Could you try the other one? Yeah. I'm not a fan of fluorescent. I like that. Are you guys okay with that? So after, for those of you who are new, after every practice, I'll ask, what was your experience? What did you notice? And part of it, and it's not always easy to, sometimes people just don't even know what to identify. I don't, you know, so what I'm really asking is, in this moment, in this experience, what did you notice about this awareness of breath for you today? Okay. Mm-hmm. So the groundiness with the legs, was that where you felt it most? Mm. Nice. Nice. So you're able to transition, be present. Wonderful. What else did you notice? So, all right, so the body breathing. Mm-hmm. Did anybody, go ahead. Wonderful. Mm-hmm. So less jumpy. Isn't that amazing?
That's.
Yeah. Did you get my Dropbox email? So you need. So the Dropbox email is a 10-minute awareness of breath, just like this. So, did anybody notice their mind wandering today? Did anybody have a wandering mind? Oh, interesting. Is it me? So sound was kind of pulling you away. Yeah. Good. What else? Anybody else mind wandering a little bit? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, actually, it does get less. It varies. Each experience is different. And so part of it is, you know, with practice. So part of it is all with the practice of mindfulness. And we do a lot of different activities, whether they're informal or formal. So this was a formal sitting meditation. We're also going to do a walking meditation. But you can bring mindfulness to your day at any moment of the day, and any way that we just did it. So one of the ways is engaging the senses. So engaging the senses of a felt touch. It can be through sight, and I think I've shared my practices when I get in the car, because it's so easy to rush from one spot to another, that when I get in the car, I intentionally make sure I feel my body in the chair. You know, I breathe, and I also visually just take in the sights to really ground myself in the present. And so where I was going to go with that, sir, is that so initially, why mindfulness, especially particularly mindfulness-based stress reduction, which is an 8-week program, why it's been so successful is that we're really rerouting our neural pathways. We're really trying to calm down that limbic system that gets so activated around stress. And so when stress is present, our whole body lights up. I mean, everybody knows it. You know, you either get headaches, stomach aches, you get jittery. Stress impacts us in a lot of different ways. And so the practice of mindfulness is bringing us into the present moment and beginning to strengthen those neural pathways so they're not always going, stress, okay, dog stress. They can be like, wait, all right, I can reroute my pathway. I don't have to be reactive. I can go a different pathway. And we're going to talk more about that today. Queenie, what were you going to share? Wonderful. So, and that's the other thing that I just want to highlight. So if you begin a mindfulness practice, it is no different than going into the gym. So if we all walked into the gym today and worked like crazy for an hour, if nobody's in shape, you know, let's just assume we're all out of shape, we decide to go get fit tomorrow, we worked out for an hour or more, we'd most likely be sore, right? But would we be in shape? No. So the exact same concept with the mind. We're really working to reroute the neural pathways in our mind, that we think our thoughts are facts. Whatever occurs up here, we think that's the fact. It's got to be true, but it's not. Our mind just wanders, and it has life all of its own, and we get to determine what part of that life makes sense and what part we want to let go of. Does that make sense? Everybody follow me? All right. So for those of you who aren't familiar, this is Jon Kabat-Zinn. So I'm trained in the Jon Kabat-Zinn model, and he's become very popular. He was a biophysicist or some biology guy, one of those things. And he was working in a hospital setting, and he had noticed that there were a number of patients who were complaining of chronic pain. They were not responding to traditional medicines, and so he asked their doctors, do you mind if I create a group? And this was back in 1976. So he created a group. He created a group of patients and began to do a more extended, a 10-week program, which is now an 8-week program. And at the end of 10 weeks, there was statistically significant change in people's perception of their pain. So perception's a key word, and we're going to come back to that. So anyways, this is his definition. Paying attention on purpose. So if you'll notice, I say the word attention a lot. All right? For those of you who've been with me for the classes now. Where does your attention go? So this is really an attention training. Does that make sense? So attention training. So we're learning to pay attention on purpose in the present moment, and the most important part is non-judgmentally, with compassion. Because what happens is that when we notice where our attention goes, we notice that critical active mind, that judgmental mind, and then we get even harder on ourselves. So it's a whole practice. Okay, so I'm talking way too much now. Please.
So I was noticing when you started talking about the awareness breath and taking us through the exercise, just like feeling calmer, and or like just all like the voice sounds so nice and relaxing. I'm glad the day's over. And like, but then also noticing that I yawn every time you do that, even though I'm not tired.
The yawning?
Or just me noticing that? Or is that
just noticing it. Okay. Yeah, just noticing. Your body might be unwinding. Who knows? It could be. Actually, I have a friend who does brain spotting, which is the neurosciences now have all these different ways of intervening. And brain spotting, when somebody's yawning, she gets so excited because yawning is really in that kind of release of kind of the tension, or she works specifically on concussions, but yawning is a release, so she gets really excited by yawning. So yawn away. Any other questions before we get started? So we're going to do another formal practice. And is everybody comfortable? There's one or two that we can do. Is everybody comfortable walking like 10 spaces and turn around? Walking, everybody? Anybody not comfortable? Otherwise, I'll give you a different option. Okay. Yeah? I got yeah? Okay. So I'm going to show this, and then everybody's going to be in different parts of the room. So a walking meditation, which is also a wonderful meditation for those of you who are walkers, hikers, or whatever. So what you're going to do is you're going to find a spot somewhere in these two rooms where you can walk. Yeah, I think everybody should be able to find it, at least 10 spaces. And what you're going to do is you're going to start out with just standing. And you can begin to, in fact, I'm going to do something with standing, just so you know what everybody stand up. So, and eventually we'll do a standing yoga. But right now, I just would like you to either let your gaze go unfocused or close your eyes for a moment. And become aware of standing and noticing what does it take to maintain your upright posture. So you may notice micro movements on your feet, on your heels. So intentionally, what I'm going to have you do just for a moment to before we move into a walking meditation is very gently move your hips right to left, front to back, with the intention of trying to get feel every part of your foot. So your toes, your heels, being very gentle. If you have any injuries, always adapt. So your intention is just to move your torso in a way that is a slight massage on your feet, trying to feel every part of your foot. So now your attention is fully focused on the physical sensations of your feet. So breathing with awareness, making sure you're breathing, and then come to stillness. All right, so you can have a seat for a moment. That will just give you a little flavor. So you're gonna start with kind of that same kind of tuning into your body. So you're welcome to close your eyes when you're kind of stopped. Make sure everybody can see me. So you're welcome to close your eyes. So you're just settling in. And then what you're gonna do is begin to lift, move, and place. Now, what's challenging about the walking meditation is that sometimes the slowness is too hard for people. So find a pace that is most comfortable for you or vary it. So I tend to go slower because I just like feeling the sensations for me of the different parts of my foot. So you're going to lift, move, and place. You want to keep your body upright. So if you find yourself starting to go like this, sometimes people keep their hands behind their back. Now your whole attention focus this time is on the physical sensations of movement. So what does it take to begin to move? Making sure you're breathing, making sure you're attuning to your balance. There's so much at play when we're walking that we often don't give it our full attention. And when you reach the end of your little section, take a moment, you know, just stop. Turn whatever way. If you find yourself turning one way, maybe turn one way the next. Even what does it take to turn? Ground yourself again and then walk back. So lift, move, place. Does that make sense to me, everybody? Are there any questions about that? So I'm going to invite each of you to go find a little section, and I'm going to time you, and we're going to do this for about 5 minutes. So stand up. Go on over. Let's use this room, anywhere in these two rooms. So like any other practices, if you notice that your mind has wandered, your attention is being caught somewhere else, that's okay. If it helps to stop for a minute, reground yourself, that's always an option. Doing the best you can to keep your focus on the physical sensations of movement. Using your breath. And take a moment returning to that mountain pose where we first started. So just taking a moment, tuning in to your body, standing here, and noticing what physical sensations are present after movement, after walking. Breathing with awareness. And then very gently, slowly working your way back to your chairs.
So it looks like a roadside sprite.
Had anybody done that before, that meditation before? So for those of you who this is new for you, I really hope what you're beginning to see is we're really dispelling the myth of what are meditations. So meditations historically of certain traditions are, you know, you often see yogis tied up in knots, and there are a lot of different ways to practice. Mindfulness-based meditation is, there's usually formal meditations of walking, body scan, sitting, eating, and I'm going blank on one. Awareness of breath, if I didn't say that. And then informal is every other part of the day. But let me ask you, in terms of this meditation of walking meditation and focusing on the physical sensations of walking, what did you notice?
Hold my breath.
Ah, that's a good awareness. So when you held your breath, did you notice a little more balance, imbalance? Yeah. So you really had to intentionally focus on breathing. Yeah. That's a good awareness.
I think as opposed to being still, meditating is harder because you have other people around, the light is changing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, when there's so much stimulation. So you found the stimulation kind of distracting.
Yeah. What's that sign say?
Yeah, and I've also done this outside, so where there are distractions, the smells. I mean, smell is a wonder, it's one of my favorite senses, along with sight. And so what we'll do is just have people stop, and once a sense kind of takes over, just stop and take it in and then proceed again. But wonderful point. What else?
Going slowly felt really unnatural to me.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Did you experiment with that?
I did.
Yes, yeah. That's common. People, when you slow it down to stay balanced, takes some attention, doesn't it? Yes. Yeah, so you really begin to notice nuances.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I do that.
Yeah.
Yeah,
that's so interesting. So the balance and staying, you know, really kind of attending. So I might have told you this. I'm going to get yoga teacher trained just because I think it'd be fun. But I have to do yoga anatomy, and I didn't realize that probably the medical people in the room do. But we have 26 bones in our foot, so it's pretty amazing what keeps us upright, isn't it? You know, what keeps us moving, and then the ability and intention to move all the parts of the body. So that's what I'm very aware of whenever I do the walking meditation, is even that inkling to lift comes up here first. So lift, move, place. It's, you know, it's kind of the all of our neural pathways talking to each other in the central nervous system. What else did you notice? Yeah.
But it also made it so a lot of times I go out hiking and I just think all the time, my mind's racing about all the different stuff. And in this, my mind couldn't wander to that.
Yeah.
I couldn't walk as well, but my mind
couldn't. Yeah. That's such a great point. Yeah. Thank you. Yeah. But it is wonderful. This is a way to bring mindfulness to your walking or hiking, is to really focus on the physical sensations of movement.
I found it very different when my eyes were open.
Yeah.
My eyes were open. It was hard to concentrate on physical.
Yeah.
There was lots of stimulus.
Yeah.
My eyes were closed. It's very much about the balance.
Yeah. Yeah, It's nice that you played with that. I tend to, it's harder for people to obviously close their eyes and walk and balance and all that, but I tend to like to close my eyes as well. I just, there's something about the sensation. I'm very drawn to the sensations of that physical touch on my feet.
I found myself counting.
That's fine. Anything to sustain that attention, because that's really what we're doing, is sustaining our attention. We're rerouting our neural pathways from where they may often wander. Oh, so it's more like the bigger muscles that. Interesting. Good. Isn't it amazing? Yeah, please. Right. It's bringing your attention to whatever. Yeah. Absolutely. I have a friend who has done a meditation on focusing on a hand. Isn't that interesting? She's done a, she'll pick different things, like a flower or a pine cone, and she'll bring it into a class like this, and that's where they focus their attention. So, absolutely. That's a wonderful point. Yeah, so really kind of noticing the distribution of weight. That's pretty cool.
I recently took a class on, you know, movement where we're barefoot. And one of the things that was brought up in that class was the importance of being grounded to Mother Earth. But I do find that we, as Westerners, you know, are Jews most of the time.
Yeah, it's a very different,
That's
such a great point.
Live their lives,
Yeah, that's such a great point. And who doesn't love to walk barefoot?
Depends on the surface.
Yes, that's for sure. So what I'd like to do is I'd like to move us into, I'm going to transition a little bit. Let me see which. It's in here somewhere. So I just want to touch on today, and I did start to touch on this the other day. Last time I asked you two questions. So actually, let me go back to that. How do you know when stress is present? Could everybody, last week we focused on that. So for those of you who weren't here, if you were to think for a second, how do you know when stress is present in your life, in your body? Everybody have a sense of when, how do you know when you're relaxed? And then what we started to focus on is how can mindfulness practice assist when stressed or relaxed? So what I want to introduce today is to begin to kind of carry that, those stress triggers. So how do we know when our body, our mind gets activated? How do you know when you're starting to amp up or activate over a situation. Does everybody have a sense of when that occurs? Okay, so the Titan. Yep. Queen? So shoulders go up. Mm-hmm. Yep. Heart rate, good. What else? I have the weirdest thing. When I start to get up, I get my jaw, right here, I get tingles. It's the weirdest thing. Like, I'll get tingles down here. I'm like, oh, I must be mad at somebody. How else do you know? Irritable. Good.
I stop sleeping well.
Okay. Good. I mean, that's not good, but you know what I mean. So, what happens with stress is we normally are activated and then we react to it. Very rarely do we take time to say, oh, I'm stressed. Let me go do a mindfulness meditation. Let me go take a walk. Let me kind of sit and have a cup of tea. Sometimes we do, but sometimes we don't. We react. But what I want to first do before I kind of head in that direction is, as I said the word earlier, and I think I only have 10 of these, so we're going to have to share. Oh, okay. So a key word in mindfulness, another key word in mindfulness is perception, how we perceive. So if you noticed when the statistically significant indicator for Jon Kabat-Zinn's group was their perception, the patient's perception of pain decreased. So perception is key in our world, and I think we can go every other person. So let's give some thought to perceptions. What is the deal with perceptions? Why are they important? And what's it have to do with stress? Huh? Right, so it's from one person's standpoint, right? And so often with a perception, how many people have had an experience of being stubborn, really believing what they, anybody experienced stubbornness before? No. So, yeah, right. So often, when we get so stuck in our perception, and it really begins to narrow our view. Does that make sense? Because we get so stuck in believing what we believe. But, kind of like this picture, and this picture is a little complicated, more complicated than what I usually use, that if you take some space and back up a little bit, have you noticed that your perception will broaden? That you begin to see somebody else's point of view. You begin to have compassion for another perspective. Does that make sense? So perception is pretty key in terms of how we view our environment. So one of the things I talked about last week, right near the end, is Rick Hansen wrote a book, Buddha's Brain, and he talks about two arrows. So the first arrow is the stressor. It's the thing that kind of gets us activated, you know, our heart rate going. It's the thing that upsets us. The second arrow is what we do with it. So that first arrow is the stress. The stress is going to happen in our life. Everybody's going to experience stress. You know, stress will not be alleviated. Stress will happen. It's what we do with it. It's what we layer on top of the stress. It's our perception of an event and where we go with it that layers on more stress. Does that make sense? Am I everybody tracking? Okay, so what we did last week, and I'm gonna do it again this week, we did mindful listening and talking. We're gonna do that again. If I can find the sheet I just had here. Oh, I think it's back here. Oh. So in a mindful listening, talking exercise, so you're gonna pair up. And there's two questions I want you to begin to explore. How do perceptions shape your life in reality? And how do we begin to notice movements of the thinking? Actually, let's have this as a conversation first because I'm going to have you do something else. Sorry. So, how do perceptions shape our life and our reality? Anything more you would add? Does that make sense? How do perceptions shape? Perfect. Right. Good. And so, with introducing... Perfect. So recently, my stepmom, who is, she's actually doing very well. She's battling stage 3 cancer, but she's in the, recently her tumors have diminished, which is wonderful. But when she was going through a rough time, it was like telephone. By the time it got to me, I thought she had fallen on the floor, and she's like, I don't even know how that happened. But it's so interesting. You get all these different versions. It kind of starts to build steam. And so my perception by that point was that she was really struggling at that time, but it had just morphed into a whole different perspective. And then what happens when we have a certain perception of an event? So the event for me was her going through a difficult time. What I did to it was I added my own stress onto it. So then I began to notice the movements of my thinking mind. Oh my heavens, I gotta get there. I have to figure out how to get to Virginia like tomorrow. And so I just got very activated. The critical voice, I can't believe I haven't been there for. The emotions, oh, this is so hard, I can't believe what, and then the bodily sensations. So we begin to notice what's going on for us after a stressor is activated. Does that make sense? Is everybody tracking what I'm saying? I'm going to invite you to move back into that. So this is a mountain pose. It's with your feet hip distance apart. And I'm going to invite you to close your eyes or just lower your gaze for a moment. And there will be the sound. We will hear sound from the other room, and that's okay. Just maybe at times noticing the sound and then redirecting your attention back. So at this moment, just standing here. And once again, moving your torso in a way that begins to feel every part of the bottom of your foot. So you're playing with balance, so be careful that you're not overdoing it. It's just very gentle, kind of like a 40% effort to begin to feel the arches, the ball of your foot, the toes, maybe each toe has a little pressure. So just a little swaying back and forth. And I know that sound, I can hear it as well. So if that gets too much, you might need to move. Otherwise, just invite it into the meditation. All right, returning to neutral. So let me say a moment about sound. And as we're standing here, let's invite sound into our awareness. So not necessarily going searching for sound, but letting sound come to you. And you may notice that it may be pleasant or unpleasant. There may be a beginning, middle, or end. And then redirecting your attention to standing here. So if that gets too, keeps pulling you away too much, you're more than welcome to move anywhere throughout this room and I'll just talk louder. All right, so standing here, upright. So imagine your head reaching towards the sky, your feet grounding in the earth. So that tension of opposites, elongating, as if there is a string pulling your head up. As your body lengthens, your torso lengthens, and breathing with awareness. So on the next inhale, and you're welcome to open your eyes if you need to, or keep them closed if you can follow my directions. So on the next inhale, we're gonna raise our arms up, sweep our arms up so our fingers are reaching towards the ceiling, palms facing one another, breathing with awareness. So on an inhale, we're going to scrunch those shoulders up, remembering that 40%. This isn't an exercise of 110. Scrunching those shoulders up on an inhale, and on the exhale, just keeping your arms up, but letting those shoulders fall back down. So we're going to do this a couple times. Inhale up, shoulders up, exhale down. So you're going to notice your arms, if your arms get a little tired, continuing to follow your breath here for a moment. So any motion that we do, always adapt it, change, follow, and listen to your own body. And letting your shoulders come back down, and slowly, as if you could feel the air through your fingertips, slowly bringing your arms back down by your side. And once you return to mountain, once again, noticing the physical sensations of movement and what it feels like now, perhaps the tingliness in your palms, maybe just that exercise of raising and lowering your arms, so perhaps sensations in your upper and lower arms. Breathing with awareness. And on the next inhale, we're just going to raise our right arm up to the ceiling. So your right fingertips are stretching up, your left fingertips are stretching down. So just a gentle stretch in opposite directions. Breathing with awareness, so perhaps that inhale is a stretch in opposite directions. Exhale is letting your body just kind of settle into normal. So just playing a little bit with this. Even just stretching your fingertips out to their entirety. And then very gently letting your left hand slide down your knee leg as you tilt over to the left. Breathing with awareness. And then coming back up. And very gently, we're going to alternate arms. So one, the left is going to come up, and the right is going to go down. So taking a moment to notice this change. And on an inhale, stretching those fingertips in opposite directions. Exhaling, letting your body return to a normal stance. Inhale. And so even imagine, if you can, stretching those fingertips out so you feel that stretch in your fingertips. And very gently letting your right hand go down the right side as you tilt to the left, right. And breathing with awareness, feeling perhaps that stretch on your left side. Breathing with awareness, perhaps into that side body. And then coming on up. And lowering that arm back down by your side. And returning to mountain. And when you return to mountain, just notice what are the sensations that are present after that movement. Noticing your body breathing as you're standing here. And on the next inhale, we're going to raise both our arms again, all the way up, palms facing one another. And this time, with both hands, we're just going to tilt a little bit to the right. So just tilting a little bit, maintaining the weight evenly distributed on your feet. So it's just a little tilt. And on the inhale, come on up. And on the exhale, going to the left. Very gently, just noticing what does it take for your body to hold this posture. Breathing up. And very slowly bringing your arms back down by your side, as if you could feel the air through your fingertips. All right, so returning to mountain, grounding yourself once again, feeling your feet on the earth, on the ground, being supported. So the next thing we're going to do, if your eyes are closed, you may need to open them. So this is going to be different for every person. So on an inhale, you're going to raise your arms up. At the apex, you pause. On your exhale, you go down. So you're only going to move your arms to the length of your breath, up and down. And it's going to be different for each person. So this is where it's good to close our eyes so we're not comparing and contrasting with our neighbors. So inhale the length of your breath. Pause. And then the length of your exhale. And you'll notice it's different every time. So a couple more, following your breath. And after that couple, just working your way back down to mountain. No rush, take your time. And when you're ready, just if you've returned to mountain once again, just checking in with the sensations. What's present now? So the next thing we're going to do is we are going to bring our right ear to our right shoulder. We're going to do some neck rolls. So very gently, so on an inhale or exhale, letting your chin come to the chest. And then your left ear to your left shoulder. So you can either go left, middle, right, whatever. But if it's comfortable for you, you can spin around and let your head tilt back and then pause again once you reach your right shoulder. So I'm going to let you decide what your neck is most comfortable with. But every movement is in-breath or out-breath. So follow your breath. And working your way around to your chin on your chest and letting it hang there for a moment. And then rotating the direction. One more full round, if that's what you're doing. And gently working your chin back to your chest. Breathing with awareness. And once your chin reaches your chest, no rush if you haven't gotten there. If your chin has reached your chest, you can lift your chin up and return to mountain. And just check in with your body now. And so we're going to begin to open our eyes if they are closed, and just very gently shaking things out a little bit, letting your body move a little bit since we've been kind of doing static positions. And very gently working your way back to your seat. So let's end with just an awareness of breath. One last quick one real quickly. So that awareness of breath is just bringing your attention to being seated. Noticing the physical sensations of where your weight's distributed. So just noticing from head to toe different feelings, sensations, emotions that may be present. As we close this day, this class, this wonderful 3 series with amazing people. So it's really been a gift for me and I really appreciate it. So just taking a couple breaths and with intention, noticing that you'll be leaving here, getting in your cars, and perhaps as you get in your car, just take a moment to settle and drive with awareness and presence, making sure you're alert, awake, in many more moments of your day than not. And you can open your eyes. I wish each of you the very best until the next series. So thanks.
Thanks.
Yeah.
I might just add.